Finally, they see it stretching out in front of them, the Yalu River, frozen over completely, and the Korean town of Hyesanjin, nestling in the snow-patched valley. Thanksgiving dinner, turkey with all the trimmings, and served piping hot, is a pleasant interlude. It brings a touch of home to the icy wastes of Korea. The machine gun crews crouched in the outpost overlooking the vast icy stretch of the Yalu River are not forgotten. The mess sergeant brings Thanksgiving to them too. Hot chow that hits the right spot when it's so cold. With turkey and mashed potatoes in extra large portions. But Thanksgiving peace doesn't last long. The Chinese hordes attack suddenly, crossing the ice on the Yalu in ever-increasing numbers. Many of them surrender. At the Changjin Reservoir, the men of the 1st Marine Division and the 7th Infantry Division find themselves trapped by 10 communist divisions. That's when the withdrawal is ordered. Retreat? Hell, snapped one Marine commander. We're not retreating, we're just advancing in a different direction. Orders are issued for all the troops to assemble at Hagaru. This time their objective is to break through and reach Hungnam on the coast 60 miles away. Through howling winds and icy blasts of snow, preparations are made for an orderly withdrawal. Back across the frozen valleys, which they had fought so hard to capture, it was tough enough when they were advancing. It was far worse to have to pull back. They are already tired, cold, and weary as they move into the assembly area, but they know they will fight their way out of the trap. Even the heaviest of armor and tanks are to be taken back. There are casualties, as much from the cold as from sniper's bullets. The wounded are carried along. The dead are buried. But the assembly for the withdrawal continues unabated. Food and supplies are airdropped from C-47s and C-119s by the 21st Troop Vast quantity of equipment that is being moved here is more easily comprehended when you think of the units involved. The 10th Corps that is being evacuated includes three full U.S. divisions, the 1st Marine Division, the 3rd Infantry Division, and the 7th Infantry Division, plus thousands of South Korean troops. The personnel involved in this move is equal to the entire population of Dayton, Ohio. Over 100,000 civilian refugees from the Hungnam area are taken to freedom along with the troops, but thousands must be left behind to the uncertain mercy of the communists. The refugees pour down to the docks until every available ship is jammed. Their eagerness to abandon their homes and possessions is pitiful proof of their fear of the communist regime. These people, who have known red domination, give dramatic evidence that they have had enough. Every effort is made to evacuate as many as possible to the Pusan area. Pusan is already swarming with hundreds of thousands of refugees who have fled from other parts of Korea. This huge migration poses a major problem to UN authorities. Loaded down with their few belongings, or a baby, the refugees push forward to the ships. The Hungnam evacuation entails the movement of 105,000 soldiers, 17,500 vehicles, and 350,000 tons of equipment. The communists, whose supply lines from Manchuria are under constant attack by our planes, will sorely miss this huge haul of military equipment, which so nearly fell to them as a prize of war. Rear guard troops hold fast on the shrinking perimeter of the beachhead with the support of naval guns from the harbor. And this valuable materiel is saved for other battles. With the United States 3rd Division fighting the principal holding action, the rest of the 10th Corps is taken aboard the evacuation ships. The 3rd Division had been fighting to the south of the Marines in the original advance to the border. In spite of the apparent turmoil, the troop evacuation is calm and orderly. The removal of the wounded has first priority. Although the more serious cases have been loaded on earlier ships or taken out by air, casualties keep coming in from the defense perimeter. In spite of the fact that our forces are greatly outnumbered, the cost in casualties is much lighter than for a comparable time during the summer defense of the Pusan beachhead. Landing craft form an endless conveyor belt running from the docks to the transports waiting in the harbor. It takes a lot of boatloads to carry 100,000 soldiers. On hand to receive the 10th Corps troops is a large U.S. Navy amphibious fleet commanded by Rear Admiral Doyle. The guns of the 7th Fleet under Vice Admiral Struble support the evacuation. This redeployment of an entire Army Corps by sea has never been attempted before. But the U.S. forces, pioneers in mass beachhead operations, simply take their well-perfected amphibious landing techniques and work them in reverse. The evacuation begun on 12 December is well along by the 20th of the month. The gallant fighting force, which fought its way to the coast against tremendous odds, takes leave of Northern Korea. But the Red Aggressors will be meeting them again.